When it comes to scuba diving, one could make the argument that no skill is as noticeable and as essential as good buoyancy and proper trim. So let's discuss how to achieve both good buoyancy and proper trim. When you first learn how to dive, there's a lot of things to learn. You need to master airway control, propulsion techniques, and of course, understand all of your diving equipment. And different training agencies will place different levels of importance on different areas. However, an argument could be made that buoyancy and trim are arguably the most important skills to master when it comes to scuba diving. This program is completely self-funded, but if you want to support Scuba Science, you can absolutely do so. First of all, of course, by liking the video and subscribing to the DiveSAGA channel, but you can also pick up some DiveSAGA merch or even become a DiveSAGA member. Our DiveSAGA All Access members also get access to behind the scenes clips, extra videos, and some of the DiveSAGA soundtracks. The first thing we need to clear out is the difference between buoyancy and trim. These terms are often used interchangeably, but they really do not mean the same thing. Buoyancy refers to your ability to float mid-water without touching the bottom or touching the surface. Someone who dives with proper buoyancy should be able to be stable mid-water, propelling themselves without a significant depth difference. Trim, on the other hand, is all about your body's position in the water, whether you are head down, fins up, or the other way around. Both are important, but they are separate. For instance, somebody could have good buoyancy, namely being mid-water, but have poor trim and be feet down. On the other hand, somebody could have good trim, but be laying on the bottom and unable to achieve neutral buoyancy. So both are important to be a good diver. Buoyancy control is based on Archimedes' principle. This states that an object in water is buoyed up by a force that is equal to the weight of the water that it displaces. So buoyancy control is all about managing our weight and our water displacement. An argument could be made that it is important to master your buoyancy control before you master your trim. As a diver, your buoyancy is affected by three things. First of all, your body, because your lung volume changes with each breath you take, which changes your volume and thus your displacement. Secondly, your equipment, depending on which diving equipment you use and the type of cylinders you dive with, plus the fact that your cylinders become empty and thus more buoyant during the dive, this will all have an effect on your buoyancy. And lastly, your weights. Every diver tends to carry weights to offset the difference in buoyancy. Having proper weighting is key to having proper buoyancy. This is why a pre-dive weight check is absolutely crucial. A diver who is properly weighted for neutral buoyancy should be able to take a normal breath and hold it at the surface, fully deflate their BCD, and be able to float at eye level. The thing that makes you sink is the reduction of displacement by exhaling. It is common practice to add a little bit more weight than that just to offset for the change in buoyancy as your dive cylinder gets more empty throughout the dive, but you can also conduct, of course, a buoyancy check with an empty cylinder and wait for this. So achieving neutral buoyancy is not rocket science, although it may feel like that when you first start scuba diving. As mentioned earlier, the key step is to first do a pre-dive weight check. Without a check like this, you have absolutely no way of knowing what your ideal amount of weight is in your specific environment with your type of exposure protection and your diving equipment. If you do start the dive with the correct weight, then it should take actually a little bit of effort to descend. You should need to exhale explicitly for you to be able to go down. As you then descend, you should be able to just add little puffs of air to your BCD. A common mistake is that people overcompensate and then get stuck in a loop of over and under compensation. Your low pressure inflator buttons should be managed with precision. And thirdly, you can also fine-tune your buoyancy with your breath. Of course, when you breathe in, your volume increases and therefore you will rise. When you exhale, your volume decreases and you will sink. Taking overly rapid breaths will make it really difficult to manage your buoyancy. As a little pro tip, I think it's very important to just master your buoyancy in shallow water first. Scuba diving with bad buoyancy is just not enjoyable. It doesn't look good, and honestly, it expends a lot of energy. So start in shallow water, where the depth differences have the largest influence on your buoyancy difference. Yes, it's harder in shallow water, but if you can master good buoyancy in shallow water, you can certainly master it in deeper water. Trim is all about balance in the water. If your body is balanced around its center of gravity, you will naturally fall horizontally in the water. It is not uncommon when divers first start diving that they are both overweighted and that their weight distribution is all wrong, causing them to hang vertical in the water and kicking for dear life to stay neutrally buoyant, which they are not. So, trim and buoyancy do go hand in hand, but as mentioned earlier, it is better to first master your buoyancy and then start working on your trim. Trim issues can come from a variety of sources. Weight placement, so weights that are positioned either too high or too low, are obviously going to affect whether we dive feet down or head down. Tank position can have an influence as well, depending on where on your body your tank is situated. And lastly, of course, also body posture. Bent knees or dragging fins will of course change your orientation and increase your difficulty while diving. So it is not super simple to achieve perfect trim. It does take a little bit of work, but once you achieve perfect trim, it will make your diving a lot easier. As mentioned earlier, start by achieving and mastering proper buoyancy. Trim adjustments are pointless if you are floating to the surface or sinking to the bottom. Then you can start adjusting your weight placement. If you already know that you're carrying the correct amount of weight based on your buoyancy check, then you can start playing around with where on your body these weights should be situated. Most modern BCDs have trim pockets for this reason. This can be a bit of an arduous process. You may need to get out of the water or ask a fellow diver or instructor to move the weights around as you play with your trim. And lastly, it's also a matter of streamlining your body and actually doing an effort to try and be in trim. So using your lower back muscles, lifting your legs a little bit, bending the knees slightly. It shouldn't be overly difficult, but if you're just hanging in the water, you're not likely to magically just fall into proper trim. To help with this, it may also help to keep your arms tucked in. Most beginning divers usually will want to use their hands and their arms a lot, but this is actually counterproductive. Once you've achieved proper trim, you will notice that it's actually somewhat natural to hang in the water horizontally without doing much effort. You'll also notice that your air consumption is drastically reduced because you are doing less effort to be in proper trim. And lastly, you may also notice that you're much more environmentally friendly and don't make any contact with the environment and kick up no silt. The secret weapon for proper buoyancy and trim is of course your lungs and your breathing. Long, slow breaths in will slowly start generating positive momentum and increasing your buoyancy. But long, slow exhales will of course counteract this and create negative momentum. The key here is slow, controlled breathing. No rapid changes, not holding your breath, no skip breathing. Just a nice and consistent rhythm of slow and deliberate breathing. Should you want to change your position in the water, you can of course breathe in a little bit more to go up and out a little bit more to go down. You can absolutely use this technique to affect your vertical position in the water column for short periods of time. If you are, of course, ascending or descending significantly, you will need to adjust your BCD. You can maybe think of it a little bit as flying an aircraft. It is important to maintain the proper trim, and then your BCD will decide the altitude. Your breath can be used to make minor adjustments as you move through the water. Beginning divers will often make the same mistakes when it comes to buoyancy and trim. The number one mistake, 100%, is to absolutely overweight Every single new diver I've ever dived with usually asks for way too much weight when they show up. Now, this can be because that's what their instructor did when they taught them how to dive. They just overweighted them because that was easy to plant them on the bottom to do some skills. In my opinion, that's not the best way to learn diving, but if that's your starting point, that may be what you're used to. So don't be afraid to shed some weight and try to do weight checks to see how much weight you truly need just to be able to go down and maintain your position in the water. A second mistake a lot of new divers make is to be kicking while they're adjusting their buoyancy. If you feel like you're sinking and you're kicking up while inflating your BCD, you're actually engaging two forces at the same time, and you'll probably lose buoyancy in the other direction and start floating up. People usually then kick down while deflating and creating the opposite effect. So kicking is really not your friend when it comes to buoyancy control. So try to carefully manipulate your LPI and find the proper amount of weight that needs to be in your BCD for that given depth, but give it some time. And the third mistake a lot of people make is just overestimating how big the changes are that they need to make. A lot of people will dump way too much air out of their BCD and then be surprised when they start falling down, or add way too much and be shocked when they start floating to the surface. So just do little adjustments at a time and have patience. If you're properly weighted, you should not require a lot of compensation. Remember, you were only just able to sink by exhaling what was in your lungs. So you shouldn't need that much extra gas in your BCD to find neutral buoyancy. It's actually a big tell. If somebody needs to make big, big changes throughout the dive, they are probably overweighted. Now, here are a few of my personal tips and tricks to improve your buoyancy and trim over time. One thing you might start considering is the weight of your actual diving equipment, especially if you have multiple pieces of diving equipment. A very good example of this is, for instance, your fins. Fins come in positive, neutral, and negatively buoyant variants, and it's important to know what type of fins you have. If you're engaging your lower back muscles and still struggle to keep your feet up, this may be because you have overly negative fins. Secondly, I find it really useful to keep notes. If you dive in many different environments, freshwater and saltwater, if you tend to come into contact with different types of equipment, for instance, aluminum cylinders or steel cylinders, and if you sometimes dive a wetsuit or a dry suit, different sizes of undergarments, it's very useful to keep notes of your ideal weighting setup for all those parameters. That way, when you travel and you end up in a situation you've been in before, you can pull up your notes and see how much weight you wore and how it was distributed. This gives you a really good starting point for those dives in that environment with that equipment. Thirdly, you should do regular checks. Your body changes as you age, and it's important to realize that what was once your perfect weight and weight distribution may no longer be effective. You may have put on some weight or lost some weight, and it's important to do these checks again regularly and then go in and adjust your notes for your current state. Propulsion techniques also matter a lot. It's important to practice good, controlled, slow propulsion and not use your propulsion too much to affect your buoyancy. And the fifth piece of advice that I would give is to also consider the buoyancy characteristics of any extra equipment that you may be diving with. The best example is probably a camera. Some camera housings are positively buoyant, others are negatively buoyant, and it's a good idea to weight and trim your camera for neutral buoyancy and trim so that it doesn't end up affecting yours. But if you are diving with a piece of mission equipment that is distinctly positively buoyant, you need to weight yourself for that, and vice versa. So here are a few exercises that you can do to improve your buoyancy and your trim. The first one is, of course, the hover drill. Now, depending on where and how and when you learned how to dive, you may have learned this in some kind of meditating Buddha position. I would say this is not ideal. While this helps to find neutral buoyancy, it is not the best way to, of course, find proper trim. So if you want to practice hovering, try to practice it in a horizontal position. Swim-through drills can be very, very useful as well, so long as you do not do them in natural or dangerous environments. But setting up some hoops, for instance, in the water and trying to swim and glide through them is a great exercise to see if you can use your breath while propelling yourself to master your buoyancy and your trim. The stoplight drill or the ascent drill is also a very good skill. Try to ascend 1 meter, 3 feet at a time and take a 1 minute stop at every depth. See if you can ascend gradually and slowly while keeping in trim and then keep the stop at that depth. This is very useful if you plan to go towards technical diving where good buoyancy but also proper trim should be expected. But in general, it's a great way to dive and to manage your safety stops. There is also a land drill that you can do if you want to practice your trim. You could consider laying yourself down on a table, chest down, with your legs off of the table, and then lift those legs, engaging your lower back muscles. This is a great way to figure out which muscles you actually need to use underwater to help affect your trim. Again, you shouldn't have to use these muscles too much, but they need to be engaged just a little bit for you to have that nice horizontal trim with your legs up. And lastly, you can do some land drills for breath control. Some meditation or breathing techniques can help and go a long way in mastering slow and controlled breathing. Most people, when they do not pay attention to their breathing, tend to breathe rather shallow and rapidly. And this is not ideal when you're scuba diving. So nice and meditative, relaxed breathing exercises can help make you a better scuba diver. And by the way, these drills aren't just for beginners. Even experienced divers should practice this regularly or when they're in a new environment or dealing with new diving equipment. In conclusion, there's no skill more immediately visually obvious than proper buoyancy and good trim, but it's also just pivotal in being a good and safe diver, especially for those divers who dive in sensitive environments or who want to venture into tech diving or underwater photography. But in general, every diver should make it a point of honor to try and be in proper trim while practicing proper buoyancy control. Guys, if you like Scuba Science, consider subscribing to the DiveSAGA channel, liking the video and becoming a DiveSAGA channel member. You can also pick up some merch from the website if you want to. Thank you guys so much for watching and I'll see you next time.